We're back. We're big. We're bad. Well, I don't know if we're big, but we're back at Jeff Lorber's. How are you?
Good to see you.
Good to see you too. This is going to be a fun one. By the way, I hope you're all doing marvelously well. Jeff reminded me that I have to say that. this is going to be a good one because one of the biggest things I remember as a guitar player, coming from a guitar player, I was always very envious of keyboard players because you develop your ear a lot faster than us guitar players do. My excuse is that, you know, guitarists have this tendency to sort of tune off of each other and the bass player, and we're sort of in E-ish. Mm-hmm. And I to this day, still do ear training exercises.
Right.
I've got apps on my cell phone. People ask me all the time. To be honest, I have like 3 or 4 different ones because they work in different ways. And I pride myself on putting on a song and learning it in the studio so that when I have to communicate to the artist, I can do that. So I get lazy. I don't write charts. Now, we were just talking about David Foster, we've both worked with, and mm-hmm. David would just chart the song out in real time as it went down. And
which is not easy.
Not easy, yes. And I showed you that chart.
Especially if it's one of his tunes that has, like, usually, I don't know, at least 2 chords per bar minimum.
Right, yeah. You know, us rock and roll guys, we like.
By the way, I play guitar, and when I play guitar, I just play the blues, like, I don't know where the notes are.
Right.
It's like, it's totally different. I mean, here I, you know, I feel very comfortable at the keyboards where I understand everything theoretically. I know where everything is. I'm like a different guy on the guitar, so I think I know what you're talking about.
Okay, great. So what I'd love to do is talk about charting songs, but more importantly, to finding the key centers, you know, any tips that you have, put yourself back at, because look, we just played, 18 bars of a song and we know the song. Now, you've got to a place where you developed a really incredible ear. But can you put yourself back into a situation when you were first learning songs? How do you sort of develop that skill?
Yeah, I mean, well, first of all, whenever I listen to music, just in general, I try to analyze it. And I don't have perfect pitch, so I usually, if it's a major song, I think of it in the key of C. If it's a minor song, I think of it in the key of A minor. And although, you know, not definitely, but that's usually what I do. And the reason why I do that is because, well, first of all, it's good exercise, number one, but it's like, it gives you real insight into how the song is constructed. Like when you think about, when you listen to it and you think about the chords, it's sort of like if you're an architect, you can see the structure of the building, you know, when you understand that everything comes from the chords. And so I think it's really important to learn, you know, the basics of harmony. You know, I think probably a lot of your listeners know, like in the key of C, like the, you know, the tonic, what are called tonic chords, like
yep.
C, E minor, A minor, and then subdominant chords, D minor, F, and maybe B flat, and then G7,
yep.
And maybe G7 with a B or would be a dominant chord.
Correct.
And so that's in the key of C. And so every, you know, once you know that, I think that the tricky thing is to learn that in every key. So no matter what key you're in, you have that kind of feeling of comfort that you know, if you're in F sharp, here's the 4 chord, 6 chord, 2 chord, 4. That's like a little passing chord to the 5, the 6. Another passing chord to the 1. So I mean, regardless of where you are, and basically, most pop songs are very simple harmonically.
Right.
I mean, you don't really have to hardly know anything about harmony to analyze 90%, especially the stuff that's out today. I think things have become a lot less harmonically complex as time goes on. Things are very minimalistic. I think it's the influence of hip hop. And people are listening to other things besides harmony. You know, if you go back to the 70s, you know, there's songs like You Are the Sunshine of My Life and Daniel by Elton John. It's very, there's a lot of chords and there's a lot of harmony. Stevie Wonder.
Absolutely.
But anyway, so I just think it's good to know the basic harmony. And then the other thing that happens in songs is that there's different key centers and it changes from one key to another and then goes back. And I was actually in preparation for us getting together. I was going through a lot of different songs and kind of checking them out from really simple songs to more complex songs. And even some of the songs that seem like they're really complex, let's say David Foster's Through the Fire, the Chaka Khan song, mm-hmm. which has tons of chords. But really, when you get down to it, it's not that complicated because they're all chords that all relate to mostly one tonality. And I think that one thing that can make a song really fun to listen to is the sense of freedom that you get by the composer has that sense of freedom to just take the chords and go wherever he wants to go, and it's not predictable. I mean, you know, like the most simple thing, you could get back to the most simple thing is like just a kind of a blues, you know. You know, 1-4 and then 5-4-1. Mm-hmm. And then you got a jazz blues, it's like this. Which is basically the same thing for the most part, except it's got a bunch of little 2-5 chord changes
right.
that lead.
I remember being a kid as a guitar player.
That intervene. Like, yeah.
And playing blues, and then getting the Joe Pass guitar style. And he's like, let's play a blues, and I'm looking at it going, that's not a blues.
Yeah.
What happened? What happened to my CFG?
Yeah, it's just a more sophisticated kind of blues.
So what's the, can you give me the guitar player's version of,
yeah.
Explain it to the dumb guitar player, what that really means.
So a regular 12-bar blues, let's say in B-flat, would be... then it goes to the 4 chord. 5 chord. So that's a kind of Chicago kind of 1-4-5 basic blues. And then the jazz thing would be. And then we go to the 4 chord. Back to the 1 chord. And then we go to the 2 chord and 5. So it's a little different. It's not quite 1-4-5. Mm-hmm. It's got some substitutions. Like the 2 chord, well, the 2 chord sort of substitute for the 4 chord. They both have a lot of the same notes.
Yep.
But the big difference is the introduction of something called the 2-5 progression. So that's a 2 of 4, and that's a 5 of 4. And that's the 4 chord.
Right.
And that's the 2 of 1, that's C minor in the key of B flat. And then the 5 chord. And then 2 and the 5 again. And one thing that's cool about 2-5 patterns, like when you're just learning how to play jazz, you can learn little melodic patterns that go over the 2-5 progression because they come up so often. So, you know, you can just start out by writing these 2-5 patterns on a piece of paper and practice them. That's the thing that's hard, is learning stuff in all the keys.
Absolutely.
That's, you know, it's easy to understand harmony, to understand the basics of harmony in the key of C, but you really need to know that in all 12 keys. And you need to be comfortable with it.
A lot of practice.
Yeah, that takes practice. And it just takes experience, because the more you play professionally or even unprofessionally, I guess, if you have a band or whatever, you just run into all this stuff and you just automatically, you know, learn it to some extent. I mean, obviously there's some keys that are more common than others.
Right.
But that's a big advantage is if you feel comfortable in all keys. And so that's something I would really recommend that everybody work on.
That demystifies quite a lot for me. I was just like, okay.
But that's one, yeah, that's so that's one of the really, really big things is the idea of the 2-5 progression, mm-hmm. which let's go back to the key of C. So in the key of C, or any kind of like D minor to G7 to C, and then you have like a C minor to F7 to B flat. That's just a cycle. Of 2-5 progressions. So that's like sort of a jazzy thing that that's been added into pop music. And the two chord is the subdominant chord, mm-hmm. 5 chord is the dominant chord. And especially in the 5 chord, you have this tritone interval where the F, which is the 7th, resolves to the E and the B resolves to the C. Etc.
Great. So, that helps a lot.
I hope so.
I think for a lot of the guitar players watching, they'll be like, oh, that's what they're talking about. Fantastic. Okay, so we were listening earlier to, well, you were here, you went to the Global Top 50.
Yeah.
So with the Global Top 50, number one at the moment is Justin Bieber.
Yes.
So putting yourself back into a situation when you were first working out tunes as a kid.
Right.
What was your sort of process? Because a lot of people, you know, myself included, you know, now I still practice this stuff. Mm-hmm. I still, as a guitar player, I feel like we're at a slight disadvantage, you know, with a more variable tuning, shall we say. Mm-hmm. And all of my keyboard player friends like you are far more advanced when it comes to your ear. You pick up things so much quicker than we do. So what is your process? What's the unique thing about it?
Well, I mean, when I was a kid, I used to just play along with records and I would just find things by trial and error. And I think most people, like that's one of probably the number one way of finding out about music. But obviously in the modern age that we live in, you know, you have, if you have like an iTunes, just whatever your music player is, you can stop it and play it over and over again very easily and, you know, start it in different places and really listen, try to find. If there's a note that you can't hear, you just kind of fast forward to that spot. There's an iOS app, I don't know if you're familiar with it, it's called the Amazing Slow Downer.
I love that. And you should find that and put it on the Amazing Slow Downer.
Yeah, it's fantastic. I mean, I actually use it. I just used it the other day. What was I looking for? There was something I couldn't hear somewhere and I had to slow it down so I could figure out exactly what it is. But it's a really nice app because what it does, first of all, it'll take any song that you have on your iTunes library or on Spotify and you can load it and then you can slow it down like 1/2 speed, I guess, and keep the same pitch, which is great. Because back in the day when we would slow stuff down on a record player, it would slow down.
Yeah,
we go
from 33 to 16.
Yeah. Yeah.
So I learned my first songs, yeah.
And then also you can set the spot that you're having trouble learning and you can sort of make it cycle. So that's an incredible,
wonderful.
You know, that's an incredible thing. But yeah, but basically, I guess, you know, basically whatever it is that you're trying to learn, you get the root, you know, you get the root of the chord to your best ability and then you get the quality of the chord. You can hear if it's major or minor and then you can hear if, you know, if it's got a dominance, like, you know, if it's a triad or if it's a major 7th chord or a 9th chord or something like that.
Well, let's just pick a song and do the...
So should we try this Justin Bieber song here
absolutely.
Again?
Absolutely.
Okay, fast forward a little bit.
Blessing, yeah. Turn every situation into heaven, yeah. Oh, you are my sunrise on the darkest day. Got me feeling some kind of way. Make me wanna savor every moment slowly, slowly. You fit me, telling me love how you put it on. Got the only key, know how to turn it on. The way you never lie my ear, the only words I wanna hear. Baby, take it slow so we can last long. But I send you money just
okay, like- so as you said, 6415. So we're in the key of D. The 6th chord is the B minor, which is the relative minor. And the 4 chord is subdominant, G, to the tonic, to the 5 chord. So that's it. That's all there is to it. They're triads. You're in the key of D. And
I think what's interesting is, like, I was always sort of taught or told that a six and a one are interchangeable. So it's interesting with the roots of rock and roll being 1-4-5, which is completely born, of course, from the blues, that here we are in 2017 and we've essentially still got a 1-4-5 song. Isn't that pretty crazy?
You know, it's funny because that group Train just recently put out a song called Play That Song. Are you familiar with that?
No, I'm not.
Which is based on, it's based on an old Hoagy Carmichael song called,
which one?
Heart and Soul.
Of course.
You know, Heart and Soul. And that's the whole thing. And so 1-6-2-5, that's definitely a very, very common progression and kind of old fashioned. So this thing is just a slight variation on that.
Yeah.
So you go back to the 40s to 2017, it's like people are listening to the same progression.
Right. And there's something pleasing about a five going back to a one or five going to the six that's kind of always kind of nice.
So we're looking at this Ed Sheeran song. So I think what I would call that, just kind of think of it in a minor key. This is sort of in a minor key. It's in D flat minor, and it kind of goes to 1-4, flat 6-7-1.
Right.
And it's kind of interesting how he has like this broken marimba accompaniment.
Mm-hmm.
Doesn't actually play the whole chords, I think. Kind of adds like a little color to it. So I think in modern music, it's just the melody really takes on a lot more importance because people want to hear, like, rather than have songs being chord driven as much as it used to be.
Melody and rhythm.
Yeah, the melody, the variations in the rhythm, in the melody just become more more important to take you somewhere rather than to rely on the...
Because interesting, as soon as I heard that, I was like, "Oh yeah, I like the feel of this track."
And well, actually, both this and the other song are similar in that they have sort of a Caribbean, you know, reggae-ish kind of roots to them. You know,
to which is great.
That syncopated groove. So yep. that always works.
Now, the Chainsmokers and Coldplay—that's an interesting combination.
Okay, so before we even go any farther, like that chord progression right there, G, A to B minor.
Yeah.
That's the exact, their hit, that song Closer, that was pretty much the same exact chords. It's the same chord progression, which worked really well for them. I think that was like 500 million streams on that tune or something like that.
Hey, you know, if it ain't broke.
But let's see if it goes anywhere else. The legends and the myths, Achilles and his gold, Achilles and his gifts, Spider-Man's control, Batman with his fist. And clearly I don't see myself in that list. She said, where'd you wanna go? How much you wanna risk? I'm not looking for somebody with some superhuman gifts, some superhero. Oh, it's the same, it's kind of the same groove a little bit. It's that Closer song.
Right.
Same synth sound. A little different. Man, and it just goes back to verse. So, yeah, so that's definitely a good example. If it ain't broke, don't fix it. So, yeah, it's just a slight variation on that. But, you know, I thought it was interesting because it has a little of that Coldplay vibe of mm-hmm. the, you know, delayed piano sound and more atmospheric sure. approach, because the closer song is very, you know, it's very, you know, rhythmically a lot more intense and less impressionistic. So,
this is fun doing this. I'm really enjoying this. I'm trying to think of somebody at random, which leads me to believe then you spend a lot of time listening to what's current, and it sounds like you do, and you know what's going on.
You know, I every Spotify New Music Friday, that's my day. I listen to all the new music.
Great.
And last week was really good. There was a lot of good songs last week. This week, I only found like one song that I sort of liked.
What was that?
I don't even remember. I have to look. Let me see what it was. Go to starred song. So it would be whatever's number one here. Oh, no, it wouldn't be that. I guess it hasn't showed up. My computers haven't been talking to each other.
But I'm fine. I'm quite happy that Let Me Love You from Jeff Beck's Truth was number one.
How great is that? Is that, you know, it's funny because
sort of massive Jeff Beck.
I was kind of thinking about that song and how great it is, and I was looking to see, like, has anybody else cut that?
I don't think so.
Because that would be a great song to do a modern, very high quality audio, you know, like killer.
Well, your starred playlist has 3,899 songs in it. God bless you. That's fantastic. Yeah, that's really, really great. Yeah, and there's some amazing songs here. You got Paramore in there.
Yeah, their new record's kind of interesting. Yeah, I think if you want to be relevant in the music business, no matter what you're doing, it helps to kind of see what's going on, to look for
absolutely
to try to find inspiration and.
So let's look at some charts.
Okay,
because I know you've prepped some wonderful stuff.
Yes, I have.
Could we start off with a couple of the like the Tom Petty start simple before moving into Chicago world?
I just grabbed a couple of, so here's a couple of Tom Petty. Whoa, Won't Back Down and Into the Great Wide Open.
So that's a beautiful chord progression. Can I go back to the dumb one first of all? Because Won't Back Down is a little dumber. It's more, I'd say, so it's E minor D G. We're talking quite a straightforward chord sequence there.
Let's listen to that a little bit so I can remember how it goes. Actually, you know, one thing I noticed about the song that was really interesting is it's short.
It's really short, isn't it?
It's like 2 minutes and, you know, 45 seconds or something, and it just ends like, bam, I won't back down, and that's it.
It's amazing. And it feels like a Beatles song to me. And what I mean by that is, like, every melody is a hook. You know, because it goes from the bridge, or is it the chorus? I mean, is this the chorus we start on, or is the chorus a bridge? It's, you know what I mean? You know, hey, baby.
Well, that's the chorus to me.
But, you know, but that Won't Back Down is
almost. Yeah, they're both very, very hooky.
Super hooky,
And also, it's sort of a tag. It's sort of a chorus. It's kind of a tag to the chorus.
Yeah. So I think of a Beatles song, and, you know, you go like, you know, baby's good to me, you know, she's happy as can be, you know, she says, I'm in love with her and I feel fine. You think that's a chorus. Then you go, I'm so glad that she's my little girl. And it goes to that, you're like, wow, that's the bridge, but it's also kind of a second chorus. You know, and I think Tom Petty at his finest is one of those writers that could do that.
Yeah, you know, normally you think like the place that everything accelerates to, like the most energetic part of the song, you usually think of it as the chorus. Mm-hmm. But I guess when you have like a really, really strong hook and that has the title in it, mm-hmm. and it's also sort of the tag.
Yeah. Yeah, beautiful.
You know, I mean, that just means you've got a good song. So you got like a bunch of, you know, great material there. Yeah, I mean, it's solid. You know, it doesn't get boring. I thought it was interesting that, so it's a little intro, verse repeats, and it's got an extra two bars at the end of the, you know, it's just like a little tag for the verse mm-hmm. to set up the chorus. And and of course those sort of slightly syncopated, let's see, where's it go? Like those those little pushes where you got those chords that are a fourth away from each other.
Mm-hmm. That's great.
You know, really adding the intensity and the power to where it's going. Yeah, I mean, it's great songwriting. What can you say? I mean, it's probably his biggest hit he's had, I would imagine.
Right up there, or Last Dance with Mary Jane, or he had a lot. Refugee, you know, going back to Damn the Torpedoes. He had a huge run. And then the other song we were talking about?
Yeah, so the other song.
Into the
Trey Biden. Put a little of that on.
And now.
It's kind of interesting because, one thing right here, it goes to that F sharp minor 7 that you don't expect. And then it goes back from there.
Yeah, it's beautiful.
And that's sort of just like an A minor over G. And then to back to the triads. You know, those sort of like those little musical cadences mm-hmm. that just really set up, that really, you know, it's punctuation for the lyrics and for the sections. And, you know, those are hooks too, right there.
Yeah, absolutely.
And
yeah, this song just washes over you in harmony and melody. It really grabs you from the beginning to the end.
And the core and the changes, I mean, compared to the other song we were just looking at, it's a little jazzier. Oh, and also, so he's like sustaining that F sharp in the guitar over the C,
which is
kind of creates like a little
five,
like
yeah.
tension, you know, yeah. little sharp yeah. 11 vibe. So yeah, I mean, it's simple, it's effective, but it's got a little bit of sophistication, and it definitely has a little bit of some unexpected twists and turns of some extra mm-hmm. bars and the way it's all set up. And I think that's really important. If every song is just real predictable, where you just have eight bar sections, it's not as interesting as when you have stuff that you don't expect. The Beatles were so great at that, because they would change feel in the middle of a song. They would have bars of 2/4 time.
I'm speculating now. I wonder where we are at the moment, where everything is essentially a variation of 6/4/1/5. Not trying to condense everything, but there's a lot of that. The immediacy is there. It's amazing. It just hits you. You're familiar with everything, but doesn't that also wash off a lot quicker?
You're talking about the modern songs mm-hmm. that we hear. I mean, it's just fashion. You know, it's just mm-hmm. the fashion. It's working for now.
But I speculate in 20 years' time, and I don't know the answer,
yeah,
but are
well,
we going to
yeah,
go back?
Yeah, I mean,
and
a lot of that music won't hold up.
Yeah.
You know, without a doubt. But, you know, that goes for.
But yeah, there went for every Beatles, there was a Herman's Hermits. Sorry, anybody who's a fan of Herman's Hermits. But, you know, there was other British invasion bands that we don't talk about. Of course, we talk about the Beatles and the Stones and the Kinks and the Who. I mean, all of those bands will be the Yardbirds. I mean, they all have a relevance, but there was other.
I mean, one thing that I've noticed, too, that's interesting is, you know, sometimes the artist has a vibe about them, like let's say Prince. You know, people just are so in love with Prince and so impressed with him and his work ethic and his catalog and all the great music that he's produced. It's a little different than the actual songs, because if you look at it from a song standpoint, it's a little different about like what songs live forever and what artists live forever. It's a little bit of a different thing.
Well, my own bias as a huge Bowie fan, I think we had both. We had songs like Life on Mars, mm-hmm. which is written by a 23, 24-year-old guy, and that sequence is insane. There's no real, you could argue it has a key center, but it's melodically moving all over the place, and you know, it's a work of art as a song, but there's also an artist there that has so much depth to him as well. So.
Right. I mean, there's no doubt that the Beatles, out of almost anybody, has, you know, their music, their writing has really, really stood the test of time. I mean, it's still so powerful. So many songs in their catalog is just incredible, you know.
Let's look at a couple of the songs you've charted, because I'm enjoying this.
Okay. Hello, Adele.
Great.
So that's another example of a modern song that doesn't have that many changes to it. Let's see what we got. You know, one thing that I really notice about this song, like the first thing I really notice is, like, if you're a piano player, this is kind of the sweet spot for the piano, mm-hmm. in terms of like, you know, it's like if you get up here, you're getting in the way of the melody, or the, mm-hmm. you know, and if you go down here, you're getting in the way of the bass. So this is kind of the sweet spot, and it leaves so much room for the vocal. It doesn't get, it's like nowhere near the vocal, so there's so much space.
Beautiful.
It just really works, you know.
Love it.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yeah.
I'm in California dreaming about who we used to be when we were younger and free.
Well, from a global thing, what I love about this song is a healthy disconnect between the music and the vocal. What I mean is the piano player feels like he's relaxed and she's a little ahead at times. So it has an earnestness to it, a sort of an urgency that makes me want to, what's she saying? It conveys more emotion rather than just being purely perfectly in time and perfect. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, well, and I think those kind of muddy minor chords, mm-hmm. like right away, it kind of sets a tone of, you know, this is serious.
Yeah.
Like this is not... Yeah. This is important. Like, check this out, because I'm saying something important. The chords, to look at it harmonically.
Yeah.
So I mean, it's like that chain smoker thing. It's, you know, it's whole steps going down from a minor chord to a major chord. But the difference is this one, instead of going to E flat, it goes to A flat over E flat. So it's just a little different, a little more interesting. And then it goes to E flat. So it's a four chord sequence, like a lot of pop music these days, but. And then, you know, and it's all like very much in one spot. And then when the chorus hits, all of a sudden it brings in, there's a B section. Yeah, that just kind of, that kind of varies. And then.
She does the minor six substitution for the E flat on the B section.
Yeah, and then her voice goes way up to the higher register, and there's more production, and it really builds.
The minor six kind of probably makes it feel more melancholy, and then suddenly when the chorus comes
in. Yeah, you hear
in,
the major key coming in with the A, you know, A flat, the relative major, A flat to E flat.
Nice.
So, yeah, obviously it's working.
Yeah, it's a combination of obviously some nice chordal changes, but with an incredible vocal. What else have we got?
Well, let's look at this one. This is a recent song which I personally really like, and it's from John Mayer's latest record. And the song's called Still Feel Like Your Man. In the key of D. Starts out with A11.
Nice.
I mean, that could almost be, well, first of all, it sounds like a Marvin Gaye song, but those chords almost sound like they could be like a Tin Pan Alley song from the 1940s. because it starts with Ale.
It's beautiful, yeah.
And then the real interesting thing about the song, this whole song stays in what's called a pedal, which means it has a bass note that doesn't necessarily, that's not the bass of the chord that's being played. So mainly what happens is the song's in the key of D and the bass note is A. So the whole song's sort of over, mostly in A pedal. So the verse is D major over A, E minor over A.
Nice.
So let's check it out. It's got the cool little riff there.
Oh, yeah.
The prettiest girl in the room, she wants me. I know because she told me so. She says, come over. I'd like to get to know you, but I just don't think I can.
Then right to the chorus.
Cause I still feel like you're mad.
Okay, so let's check out what happened. So, chorus went E minor over A, it's still A11. And then F sharp 7, flat 13. Which should resolve to B minor, I guess, but then it just goes back down to E minor, A11, then F sharp, and then F sharp over A sharp, which is really nice. And then it resolves to B minor.
Nice.
So it's sort of like, it almost resolves to B minor, and then it actually does it. It sort of sets it up.
Creates a little bit of
So that's it. That's the whole thing, and it works great. Then it repeats.
I still keep your shampoo in my shower. In case you wanna wash
Great.
Your hands.
Sonically, it's like
Beautiful.
Ridiculous.
Yeah.
It's unbelievable.
And I know that you probably found yourself some more somewhere. But I do not really care. Cause as long as it is there, I still feel like you're mad.
Okay, so that's totally unexpected. Goes to a half-time breakdown. Up a half step from the key of the song, which we never actually felt the key of the song that much because we never really played a D ever. But then it stays in E-flat for quite a while. Oh, there's B-flat. So
it's gorgeous.
That's the whole thing.
Yeah.
And once again, I mean, to me, the fun of the song is that it just goes, it just has a feeling of a lot of freedom. It goes places you don't expect. Mm-hmm. It sort of, you know, doesn't, you know.
It's a nice balance with those tight little funky guitar lines, kind of keeps that groove with the kind of, yeah, beautiful there. That's a beautiful production.
Yeah. So.
What else have you been charting?
Okay.
I think maybe we're in... In for some Chicago now and get a little.
Oh, look out for that. Okay, well, you know, because I was looking at the John Mayer stuff, I kind of heard this. And I was sort of checking this out. Axis Bold as Love by
Jimi Hendrix.
Hendrix.
That's a nice direction to go in.
Let's take a look at that one.
There it is.
Oh, you found it?
Nokia, yeah. Yeah.
Okay, so we're in A-flat.
Tennessee and me.
So, first of all, I think like the one thing that really sticks out is this chord change right here. It's just chromatic major chords, but I don't know, it sounds so cool.
It does sound really cool, yeah.
And it's kind of unexpected. But yeah, so the song's in the key of A. So it's 1-5-6-4. Oh, your favorite chord progression, right? 1-5-6-4. But then it's got this next change. 4-1-2-7. 4-1-2-, and then we have. So that's the verse, and then the chorus. So 1-5-6, and then the chromatic. And then I don't know if Jimi Hendrix does that. That right. might have been John Which Mayer's band? Addition. That D flat major 7 that he does on the fourth bar of the chorus.
Play it for me. I definitely.
I don't want to say no
because Hendrix was so unpredictably.
Well, it definitely sounds
great.
More jazzy the way it comes
off. It definitely sounds
here.
More jazzy where it comes off there. I'd have to go back and listen.
But yeah, so I guess it's very modern because it's like 1-4-6-5 or you know.
Yeah. I see you have Elton written underneath there.
Yeah,
your song.
So okay, so that's like a whole other thing. So your song. And you know he wrote so many songs that were kind of like this, that were. That were just very rich harmonically, had sort of that tin pan alley, with a lot of voice leading, a lot of chromatic chord movement. Like right here, kind of classical. Bar 2-4 time. Back to 1. Back to the root. Bar 2-4 time. And you can tell everybody this is your song. It may be quite simple, but now that it's done. And then here's that chord progression you like. Oh no, it's a little different. 2-4. And you know,
beautiful.
I mean, it's interesting. You know, just listening to it, it sounds complicated. But when you actually write the chords out, 1-4-7-3-6, and that's kind of interesting. That's really nice. So he goes from the sixth chord. To an F over A to F minor. So an F minor is the two chords. So this is just a passing, but it's a really nice passing chord. And then 5, one over the B flat to 5. And then once again, a passing chord to the sixth degree, C minor. The root, 2-4-5. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So I guess it's a little bit complicated, but it's just all moving mostly.
A lot of leading chords make, yeah.
I mean, mostly it's just diatonic harmony that's just kind of moving around to different degrees of the scale, of the E flat major scale. And then, but it definitely, it starts on the root and it ends up on the root. And then the chorus, he kind of gets away from the root. He kind of takes it, you know, it doesn't start on the root. It starts on this chord, going to the sixth, two, four, and then it repeats. And then it kind of makes that relative minor, it really emphasizes the relative minor. And then you get back to the root for a second.
Beautiful.
So,
a masterpiece.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's great.
We're going to round up with I'm Not in Love by 10cc, a pure masterpiece.
Yeah. So I was checking this one out. So this is, yeah, you can make that work. I think I got that sound in here somewhere. So the song is in A, but it starts out a whole step up in B11. Song's in E, but it takes like forever to get there.
Right. Don't get me wrong,
don't think you got it. Okay, so what's happening is the song's in E, but it starts on the four chord. Then it goes to the relative minor, D flat minor. Resolves. Anyway, we can listen to this. I'm not in love. No, no. It's me. A little syncopation. So that's like the one place in the whole record that sort of sounds like blues a little bit. Which is like, wow, where did that come from?
You know? Love it.
It's like, you don't expect that. I love to see you, but then again, it doesn't mean you mean that much to me. So if I call you, don't make a fuss, don't tell your friends. Acid trip for like 10 minutes. But you know, but this is a good example of like, this is such a cool song. And I think most people, when they hear it, you know, they just go into a dream state immediately. And you don't really think about the harmony. But if you look at the harmony is really cool and it's not that complicated. So I think, you know, one thing, if you're a musician, if you're a songwriter, you can look at this stuff and you can sort of understand it and figure out, like, you know, you can use that in your own writing and in your own compositions, and just make that part of your arsenal. You know, it gives you just another way to appreciate what they're doing and another way to enjoy it too.
Wonderful. Well, thank you ever so much.
All right.
This has been amazing. now I feel
it's
like
it's been wonderfully marvelous.
Wonderfully marvelous. I feel like we're just scratching the surface. So have a marvelous time recording and mixing. We'll get stills of all these, and you'll be able to download them. So while we're talking, you'll know exactly what the chord sequences are. So have a marvelous time recording and mixing. Please leave a bunch of comments and questions below.
And if I wrote any wrong chords in my charts, I usually just scratch them out really fast. So that's why that happened.
Have a marvelous time recording and mixing.